Welcome, my name is Jason Johnson and thank you for watching this video. If you find anything helpful in this video or any of my videos, just go ahead and subscribe to my channel so you can see future updates. And if you have any questions, just leave a comment below and I'll try to get back with you as soon as possible. If I don't have an answer to your question, I'll try to point you in the right direction. Okay, well this video is going to be chapter one in the video series for the NETACAD IT Essentials course. We are going to cover in chapter one the personal computer systems. So let's get started with this. So when we're talking about the personal computer systems, we first want to talk about cases and power supplies. And with a case that you're going, or cases that you're going to be using in putting a computer together, you need to know the different types of cases for the different types of computers. Now, with cases on a computer, you're going to have different types. You're going to have tower cases. You're going to have horizontal cases that stand up. You're going to have full-size tower cases. You're going to have compact towers. You're going to have all-in-one type of cases that come with computers. So you need to be familiar with all those. For this material and specifically for the A-plus course or the A-plus certification, you need to know which types of cases are out there so that they run from the different sizes from anywhere from the tower. So you just need to know all the different ones are out there, because then when you're learning the types of motherboards, you need to know the types of motherboards and what types of cases that they will go into. You also, when you're wanting to choose a case, you want to make sure that you have one that provides good airflow, because any overheating on a computer is not a good thing. And you want to make sure that the size that you're choosing is going to fit in the environment that you need. So if you are choosing for a company and they've got a desk size area that's really small and they need a small form factor, you need to get a small slimline case to be able to put that type of computer in there. The next thing we're going to look at is power supplies. And on power supplies, what you have to focus on a power supplies is what the power supply does is it provides power to all the computer components in your computer case. And it needs to be chosen based on current and future needs. You need to make sure that if you're going to add maybe another hard drive, maybe you're going to add a second CD-ROM, or you're going to add a CD-ROM burner into your computer, you need to make sure that the power supply that you're choosing is going to provide enough power for the current needs and the future needs. And you also need to know that the power supply delivers different voltage levels to meet different internal component needs on there. And another thing I'm going to say here on this is on these power supplies, you need to make sure, if you see where I'm drawing right down there, there's usually a switch on the power supply that changes that setting on there. And that setting on the back is typically on most power supplies is going to be a setting between 115 or 230. And you need to make sure that you have that switched to be to match the voltage that is coming into your house, or match the power supply in your house or your business or whatever, wherever you're located. Now, when we are looking at calculating power supply wattage, that is the power equals voltage times amps, and that's how you can calculate this. There's a lot of other videos out there on how to calculate voltage and amps in your power. So I'm not going to cover it in this video here. This is just an overview of that, but you do need to understand this concept of the voltage and amps and how to calculate that. So when you take the NETACAD course, there's going to be more material in there. This is just an overview in the PowerPoint here. Okay, so when we're talking about motherboards, we're talking about the internal PC components now. We've talked about the power supply, but when we talk about motherboards, the motherboard is what holds everything together, and that's why it's called the motherboard, kind of like the mothership. If you're talking about an alien spaceship, you're talking about the mothership or the motherboard. It's where everything plugs in, your CPU, your graphics card, your power supply is going to power everything, your RAM, your random access memory is going to plug into that, and so all of your components tie in through the motherboard. And when you are selecting a motherboard, you need to select it based upon your needs of what you're going to have, what type of graphics processor card you're going to have, what type of RAM you're going to have, what type of processor you're going to have, what type of case you're going to put it in. So if you're going to be putting it into a slimline case, you need to make sure that you select a motherboard that's going to go for that. And for the A-plus certification, you need to know the different types of motherboards. I'm not going to cover it in this video here, but you do need to look up and review and probably memorize the different types of motherboards that go into the case in there. The next component is the CPU or central processing unit. That's really, it talks about being the brain. That's where most of the process, and I won't say all the processing, that's where most of the processing is done for your computer, because sometimes depending upon your components, you can have some processing done in other areas of your computer. But that's where the main bulk of your operating system is going to send the processing or do its calculations through that CPU. And your CPU is going to be chosen depending upon what type of motherboard. So if you are going to choose an Intel or an AMD, you have to get a motherboard that fits that particular CPU. So you can pretty much say that the CPU and the motherboard are going to be tied together in the type that you're going to choose. Now, the next component here is the cooling system. You want to really focus on making sure that you get the correct cooling system for your motherboard and for your case, because the cooling system is what keeps the temperature down. And as you're learning about computers, you're going to find out that heat is an enemy of your components, of any electronic components. Heat is not a good thing. So the hotter something gets with electronic components, the more risk you're going to do, or the more risk you have of damaging something in there. So you want to make sure that you have good fans, good cooling components in there. You want to make sure that you select a case. I know I've seen people where they cut extra holes in the sides of their case and they put extra fans in. You just need to make sure that the proper flow is maintained through your computer. When you're dealing with servers, most server manufacturers, in fact, I'll say all server manufacturers, they design their cases on their servers to make sure that the proper airflow is going through. So you want to make sure that when you're adding extra cables in, when you're putting extra components in, and you can see in this picture right here where we have a graphics card here, or an extra card that we have, and it's got a fan built onto it. But as we put more components in, those are going to generate more heat. And so in the past, I've had fans that set into slots here, and they take air and suck it out of the case. I've put fans on the sides of the computer. You can get into water cooling. There are water cooling units that you can put into a system, so you might want to check that out as well. Okay, so next let's take a look at memory, both ROM and RAM, and those are different. ROM is read-only. It stores data permanently. It stores firmware information and low-level programs. It's so that if your computer turns off, that information is still there. RAM is what we like to call, it's volatile memory, which means that if the power goes off your computer, everything that's stored in your RAM or random access memory, you lose it. It dissipates and it goes away. And so it's temporary storage. It aids in the processing. So the processor sends information over to the RAM to hold it temporarily, or to do some of that, you know, to pass it through on there. But the RAM is what allows, you need to know that RAM is volatile. And if you, in other words, when your computer's turned off and you've lost information, that information was stored in your RAM at the time, and that's why it wasn't saved to either a hard drive or written to some type of device. Other components inside your PC, you have adapter cards and expansion slots. Adapter cards could be anything from you might need to attach SCSI, I'm not going to go into what SCSI is, SCSI, in this video, but you can look that up. Let's say that you have to attach a SCSI, some type of scanner system into your computer. Well, you would put a card in, and you could put it into the expansion slot here, and it would allow that expansion or those cables to be able to connect in on the back. So those allow extra devices or extra components to be added into your motherboard. Storage devices, those are something that you're going to do what we call permanent storage or long-term storage. Those are going to be your hard drives. That's where your operating system is going to reside. That's where your files are going to reside. That's where anything that you want to write to it that after you turn your computer off that you want to keep long-term is going to be written to that device. Those can be internal or external, and you can connect those through USB cables, and you can connect those through other types of, SCSI was another form factor back in the day. It still is that helps you store information puts information on a storage device. Video ports, you need to know the different types of video ports. You need to know HDMI. You need to know VGA. You need to know digital visual interface, the DVI. You need to know all those different types of connectors. But just at this point, you need to know that you have video ports. They can be internal or they can be tied into the motherboard. A lot of motherboards have that, have a VGA or have some type of video component to it, or you can add an extra card in that allows you to have video. that comes in. And then you've got your general ports. Most computers today, and this is 2017 when I'm recording this video, most computers today are not going to have the old PS2 keyboard mouse connectors, but you may work on some, and you still need to know those ports for the CompTIA A-plus certification exam. And you just need to know that your general ports, like your USB ports and your other types of ports, allow connectivity between your motherboard and other types of devices such as printers, external storage, video cameras, and the such. Now, the last few components we're going to talk about here is video-related and video ports and related cables. Those are there's different standards govern different types of traffic, whether it's analog or whether it's digital. And a couple of standards that it talks about here is HDMI and DisplayPort. Those are examples of video ports that require a specific cable to operate. And you do need to know those different types of cables. You do need to know HDMI, DisplayPort, DVI, the different types of DVI. You need to know those for the exam. There are other ports and related cables, too, that you'd have to have. Motherboards have a number of other ports used for connectivity. USB is a common example where you would have a USB plug-in on the front of your case. And then there's a cable that goes from that USB to the back of that USB port to your motherboard, which plugs directly in. And then you have adapters and converters. Those can be a motherboard does not have a proper port to connect to a device. You would add an adapter in. Let's say that you have VGA coming out of the back of your computer. Or let's just say that you have DVI coming out of the back of your computer and your computer monitors VGA. So you can have these converter devices that will convert it from digital over to analog. In this case, DVI over to RGB, or excuse me, VGA. Adapters usually do not usually process the signal. They simply just redirect it to another pin. They're just crossing it over. And converters are more likely to process the information and transform the signal, converting that from a digital to an analog. But an adapter just adapts it. A converter does do some type of conversion on that signal. Okay, so let's move over to selecting computer components for our devices, for our computers. When we're selecting computer components, there's some things that you need to make sure that you focus on. You need to select the motherboard, CPU, case, and memory at the same time, because that memory, that CPU, and that the heat sink and that case are all going to go together. You're going to make sure that you have a motherboard that's going to fit the right case. You're going to make sure that that memory fits that motherboard. You're going to make sure that that CPU that you're selecting does fit the correct socket on the motherboard you're buying. And then usually you're buying your CPU and your heatsink at the same time. Those usually come as a package deal. I would recommend always, you know, when you're purchasing a CPU to make sure that you get the proper heatsink that goes with that one. Otherwise, don't buy third party, you know, buy the ones that go directly with it on that. The case, let's see here. So a motherboard should support all customer required applications and still fit the proper size. The case should be host the motherboard. Make sure that you have the proper power supply. The CPU needs to be compatible. The memory needs to be compatible. And the amount of memory will depend on the application requested by the customer. So if you need to make sure that if you're going to be doing virtualization where you need a lot of memory, let's just say you need 32 gig of RAM or more, you need to make sure that that motherboard is going to allow you to be able to plug that amount of RAM in and that everything's going to be able to handle that. So you just need to make sure that you are looking at that for your needs. Now, the last thing I want to talk about here is configuration for specialized computer systems. You are going to come across systems where you have to specialize in what you're building. In this case, you might have what they call a thick or a thin client. For example, a thin client might be a very small device where you're going to do most of your processing on the server side. Where you're in an environment where you can't have, and an example of my work history, I was in an environment where computers had to be out on the work floor. We were a paint processing company, and there was lots of paint dust that was in that environment, and we could not have a regular computer out on the manufacturing floor. So what we had to do is put thin clients in because they did not have any type of air moving through that component, and then we had to put it inside of an area where we could cool it, and it would not suck in all that, all those paint fumes and all that paint dust. So you need to make sure that you take that into account. You might have a CAD system, computer aided design system. You need to make sure that you have plenty of RAM on that and processing power. Usually, what you're going to do in these cases is you're going to look at the software requirements. And I'll just say in an example, let's just say the software tells you that it's going to need 4 gig of RAM to operate. on a minimum standard. So you know that you're going to need to have enough RAM for your operating system and then enough RAM for your application and then extra, because if that's a minimum requirement of 4 gig, you know you're going to want more than that so that it'll run smoothly. And then last, if you're doing audio and video editing, you want to make sure that if you're doing audio and video editing that you have the right RAM or right amount of RAM or more, that you have right type fast disk. Because if you're doing a lot of processing and having to write to a drive, you're going to drop frames and you're going to drop information if you don't have it writing fast enough to your computer. So you want to make sure that you have enough types of hard drives. So you might put an SSD drive in instead of regular drives. If you're doing virtualization, you need to make sure that you have enough RAM. If you're doing a gaming PC, that you need to make sure that you have the proper cooling, that you have the right CPU. I know on my gaming computer, I put my processing on SSD drives, and then I have a storage device, which is still a spin drive on there, and then I upgraded on my laptop where I just have double SSD drives in there so that I can I don't really have any spinning going on in there whatsoever, so everything writes faster. If you're doing a home theater PC, you need to make sure that you have the right output. So if you're going to do HDMI out or you're going to do another type of video out, video signals, you need to make sure that you are getting those right cards or those right components that'll be able to connect in there. Okay, so this was chapter one for the IT Essentials. We covered a lot of different topics in this video. If you take, or you should be taking the NETACAD IT Essentials course, and if you take that, there's going to be a lot more information in the material presented in that course. But we've talked about computer components, we've talked about cases, we've talked about processors and RAMs and hard drives. We've talked about specialized computer hardware components, so that if you need to make sure that you're selecting the right components and the right amount of RAM, the right CPU for the job that's going to be required for that. Okay, so that's the end of this video here. I should have some other videos coming up here on your right side that will show you to the chapter two and beyond. And also check out my other videos, subscribe to my channel, and I hope you have a great day.